Hello, I am pleased to present another guest tutorial here on the Coding Train. And today's guest tutorial is from Yining Shi. And Yining Shi is an artist and researcher. She's an alum of the program ITP where I teach. She was also a resident researcher for a year here at ITP, and she's done a lot, she made a lot of contributions to p5js.org. Notably, this project called P5 Playground, which is totally amazing because usually you think about, oh, I'm gonna write some code and I'm gonna change the code and then I'm gonna see a new result. But here, watch this. I'm gonna move this ellipse around and watch what happens to the code. The code is changing. So this is P5 Playground, which allows you to manipulate the shapes on the canvas and see the code changes in real time. She also has something called P5 Live Coding, which is the other way around. And I encourage you to check out Yining's website to learn more about her work with P5 and other projects that'll be linked to in this video's description. But what you are about to see is Yining showing you a clever twist, how to build a brick breaker-like game. Someday I hope to maybe do my own coding challenge of brick breaker, but you'll see Yining's. It's really wonderful. And this brick breaker game was actually featured on the p5js.org homepage as well. So enjoy this video tutorial. Thank you, Yining, and I will see you all in another video. Goodbye.
Hello, everyone. My name is Yining. I am a researcher at NYU ITP. I recently made a brick breaker game in P5.js, which was featured on P5's homepage for 2 weeks in June. The original inspiration for this game was Daniel Schiffman's Asteroids coding challenge. So now I'm here at Dan's studio where he makes all his coding train videos. And I'm going to talk about how to make a brick breaker game in P5. Before we start, let's take a look at the final result. This is the original game, and today we're going to make a simple version of it, which is this one. You can see the result and the code on my GitHub account. I will make sure to include all those links in the description below. So in the game, you can press S to start the game. And press A or D key to move the paddle around. Once the ball hits a brick, the brick will either become smaller or disappear, depending on the size of the brick. And we're going to use P5 to make this game. In case you're not familiar with P5, P5 is a JavaScript library for creating animations and graphics in the browser. So here I have a basic P5 code template. I have my index.html here, which includes the basic structure of the website. And I am importing 3 P5 libraries here. And I'm also including 4 JavaScript files that I created. Let's go to the whiteboard to outline the gameplay first. We have 3 key elements in this game, a paddle, a ball, and bricks. A paddle can move to the left or to the right, and a ball can bounce around the canvas. And if the ball hits the paddle or if the ball hits the brick, the ball can bounce off. And a larger brick will become smaller, and a smaller brick will be destroyed if it's hit by a ball. Let's keep it simple for now and assume that if all the bricks are destroyed, the player will win this game. Now we have our gameplay defined. Let's think about how we can approach each of the dynamics in a P5 sketch. So in a P5 sketch, we need to draw a paddle that can move to the left or to the right when we press A or D on the keyboard. And we also need to draw a ball that can bounce off of the surfaces and some bricks of different sizes. And we need to write some logic to figure out what will happen if the ball meets the paddle or if the ball hits a brick. Finally, we need to write some simple logic to start or end the game. So as we discussed, first we need to draw a paddle. In order to better organize my code, I have created a file called paddle.js, and in this paddle.js file, I have a function called paddle. So in this function, I am going to give the paddle its width and height. This the width equals to 160. This the height equals to 20. And I'm also going to assign the paddle its initial XY position. This the path equals to, in P5 there is a function called createVector that can create a vector object. So we're going to use that function, createVector, and we're going to pass the XY position to this function, which will be width divided by 2 and height minus 40. The width and height variables here are the width and height of the canvas. And I'm also going to have a display function. This dot display equals to function. This display function will actually draw a rectangle on the canvas. In P5, there is a function called rect, which will take four arguments, which are x, y, width, and height. And we're going to use rect function to draw a rectangle on the canvas. So rect, we're going to pass the x, y position of this paddle, which is this dot pause dot x, this dot pause dot y, this dot width, this dot height. And now we have our paddle class defined. Let's go back to sketch.js to create a paddle object out of this paddle class. So at first, I will have a variable called paddle. And then in the setup function, I will say paddle equals to create, not create, paddle equals to new paddle. And then in the draw function, I am going to call the display function of the paddle object to actually draw a rectangle on the canvas. So now if I save my code and run my code, we should be able to see a rectangle at the bottom of the canvas. We are also going to have a function called this.move. This function is responsible for changing the x position of the paddle. Also, I want to be able to control the amount of displacement of the paddle, so I'm going to pass a variable called step to this move function. So in this move.function, we're going to change the x position of the paddle. This.pause.x plus equals to step. So we will add a step to the x position of the paddle. And now in the sketch.js, if I call paddle.move, save the code. When we call this move function, I'm going to pass 20 to this function. So in this case, step will be 20, and we will add 20 to the x position of the paddle every time when the draw function is called. So if we run the code again, we will say the paddle moving to the right. But we don't want to move the paddle unless we press A or D key on the keyboard. So in the sketch.js, we will have a function called keyPressed. This key press function comes from P5. It will be called every time a key is pressed. So in this key press function, I will say if key equals to lowercase a or the key equals to uppercase a. If the key is a, I will move the paddle to the left. Else if the key is d, I will move the paddle to the right. In order to decide the moving direction of the paddle, in the paddle.js, we're going to have two more properties for paddle. So this dot is moving left. This dot is moving right. They are Boolean flags, so at first they will be false. And back to sketch.js, we will say if the key is A, we will set paddle.isMoving left to true. And if the key is D, we will set paddle.isMoving left, moving right to true. So now we will know the moving direction of the paddle. So back to paddle.js, we will have another function called this.update. This function will update the x position based on the paddle's moving direction. So in this function, I will say if this dot is moving right is true, I will call this the move function and pass 20 to this function to increase the x position by 20 every time. And also if this dot is moving left is true, I will also call this move function, but I will pass negative 20 to it to decrease the x position by 20 every time. Back to sketch.js, we will replace paddle.move function with paddle.update function and save the code and let's run the code again to see what happens. So here is the paddle, and if I press A key, it should move to the left. And if I refresh the page and press D key, it will move to the right. But you might notice that once we press the A key, the paddle that is moving left will always be true, so the paddle will keep moving to the left. So we need another function to detect if I release this key. Once the key is released, we will change paddle.isMoving left to false again to stop the paddle from moving. So in the sketch.js, we will have another function called keyReleased. It will set paddle.isMoving left to false, paddle.isMoving left, right to false. This key, the key release function is from P5.2. This function will be called every time when we release a key. So let's run the code again. So now if I press A key and then release it, the paddle should move to the left and then stop. And if I press D key, the paddle should move to the right. And if I release it, it should stop. Yay, it works. Okay, the last thing that we need to do for paddle is to check the edges, because for now, if I move the paddle to the left, the paddle will move out of the canvas, and we don't want that. This is the X position of the paddle. So we will say if the X position of the paddle is less than zero, that means the paddle is definitely out of the canvas. We will set the X position of the paddle back to zero. And here, this is the X position of the paddle too. And if the X position of the paddle is beyond this point, we will know that the paddle is definitely out of the canvas too. And this point is actually the width of the canvas minus the width of the paddle. So it's this one. And if this happens, we will reset the X position of the paddle back to width minus the width of the paddle. In the paddle.js, we are going to have another function called check edges. Edges equals to function. And we will say if this.pause.x is smaller than zero, this.pause.x will be zero. If it's out of the canvas, we will reset it back. And else if this.pause.x is more than the width of the canvas minus the width of the paddle, we will reset it back to the width of the canvas minus the width of the paddle. Okay, and now if we call check edges function in the draw function dot check edges, save the code and run the code again. Now if I press A key to move the paddle to the left, even if I'm still pressing A key, the paddle cannot move out of the canvas. Same with the D key. If I keep pressing D key, the paddle cannot go out of the canvas either. Cool. So this is the end of the paddle.js. The next step is to draw a ball. The ball will have its initial XY position and the initial moving direction, and it can move around the canvas. When it hits the edges, it can bounce back. So now I'm going to give the initial XY position to the ball. So this.pause equals to create vector. I want this ball to be the center of the canvas. So I will say width divide by 2, height divide by 2. And I also want to give the ball its radius. So this.r equals to 30. Then let's have a display function to actually draw a circle on the canvas. So this.display equals to function. In P5, there is an ellipse function that can draw a circle. So we will use this ellipse function. It takes x, y, width, and height. So this.pause.x, this.pause.y, this.r, multiply by 2, this dot r multiply by 2. because ellipse function takes the diameter of the circle. So we need to multiply it by 2. Okay, so now back to sketch.js. We will use this ball class to create a ball object. So here we will say var ball in the setup function. Similarly, we will have ball equals to new ball. And in the draw function, we will say ball.display. And if we save the code, run the code again, we should be able to see a ball in the center of this canvas. So the next step is to move the ball. In order to move the ball, we need to give the ball its direction and velocity. So back to ball.js, we're going to add two more properties, and they are both vectors. This.direction equals to create vector 1, 1. This means the direction of the ball is 1 on the x-axis and 1 on the y-axis. So the ball will move towards to the right bottom of the canvas at first. And then let's give the ball its velocity equals to create vector. And we are going to multiply this vector by 8. We use this number to control the speed of the ball. So the bigger this number is, the faster the ball will move. And here let's have a new function called this.update. So we will use this function to update the position of the ball based on its previous position and its velocity and direction. So here I will say this.pulse.x plus equals to this.var.x multiplied by its direction. X. So this means the x position of the ball is itself plus the velocity and multiplied by its direction. So the same with its y position. This.pulse.y plus equals to this.velocity.y multiply its y. Cool. So now we have this update function. So in the sketch.js, let's call this update function to update the position of the ball. The update. And we save the code and run the code again. We should be able to see the ball moving towards to the right bottom of the canvas. But now the ball will just move out of the canvas after a while. We want the ball to bounce back when it hits the edge of the canvas. So like the paddle function, we are also going to have a check edges function in the ball function. So this dot check edges equals to function. And in this function, we're going to check if the ball hits the edge of the canvas or not. So in this game, if the ball hits the bottom of the canvas, the game will be over. But let's come back for this later. And for now, we're going to check all four sizes. So for this one, we will say if the y position of the ball is less than its the radius of the ball, and the y direction of the ball is less than 0, we will know that this ball is hitting the top of the canvas and also it's moving towards to it. So if this happens, we will reverse its y direction by multiply its y direction by minus 1. Similarly, if the ball is here, and the y direction of the ball is more than the height of the canvas minus the radius of the ball, and also if its y direction is more than zero, we will know that this ball is hitting the bottom of the canvas, and we will reverse its y direction too. And here we will say if the x position of the ball is less than the radius of the ball and it's moving to the left, in this way its x direction will be less than zero, we will reverse its x direction. And here, if the x position of the ball is more than the width of the canvas minus the radius of the ball, if this happens, and also if the x direction of the ball is more than zero, we will also reverse its x direction. So here in the ball.js, in the checkEdges function, I will just say if this .pulse.y is less than the radius of the ball, this.r, and this.direction.y is smaller than zero, then we will know that this ball is hitting the top of the canvas. We will reverse its y direction, this.direction.y multiply minus 1. And similarly, if this.pulse.y is more than the height of the canvas minus the radius of the ball, and the direction, the y direction is more than zero, we will also reverse its y direction. Also similarly for x direction, we will say if its x position is less than its own radius, and also its x direction is less than zero, we will know the ball is hitting the left side of the canvas. We will reverse its x direction. Similarly for this one, if the x position is more than the width of the canvas minus the radius of the ball, we will know, and also the x direction is more than zero, we will know this ball is hitting the right side of the canvas. We will also reverse its x direction. So this is our checkEdges function, and if we call this function in our sketch.js, ball.checkEdges, and save our code and run the code again. Yay! So now we have a bouncing ball. Great. So the next step is to make the ball interact with the pedal. When the ball hits the pedal, the ball will bounce off too. Let's see, this is our pedal. This is the XY position of the pedal. And this is the XY position of the ball. Actually, we will know that if the Y position of the ball is in this range, and the X position of the ball is in this range, we will know that the ball is meeting the pedal. So let's take a look at those two ranges. For this range, this range. So this is the Y position of the paddle. So this is Y. And this point is the Y direction of the paddle minus the radius of the ball. And for this range, this point is the X position of the paddle minus the radius of the ball. And this point is the X position of the paddle plus the width of the paddle plus the radius of the ball. So here, back to ball.js, we're going to have a new function called meets. This.meets equals to function. And in this meets.function, it will take a paddle as its parameter, and it will return true or false. True means the ball is meeting the paddle, false means it doesn't. And remember, we talk about those two ranges. If the X is in this range and if the Y is in this range, we will know that the ball is meeting the paddle. So here I'm going to say if this dot pause dot Y is smaller than the paddle dot pause dot Y, and also this dot pause dot Y is bigger than paddle dot pause dot Y minus the radius of the ball, which is this R, and also this dot pause dot X is more than this paddle dot pause dot X minus its R, and this dot pause dot X is smaller than the X position of the paddle plus the paddle's width plus its own radius. If this happens, we will know that the ball is meeting the paddle, so this function will return true. Otherwise, it will return false. Cool. So let's save the code and then back to sketch.js. In the draw function, we are going to check if the ball is meeting the paddle all the time. So we will say ball.meets, and we pass in our paddle object. So this function will return true or false. So we will say if ball meets the paddle, and also, we are going to check the y direction of the ball. If the y direction of the ball is more than zero, that means it's moving down to the paddle. So we will say ball dot direction. Dot y is more than zero. This way, we will know that the ball is hitting the paddle, and then we were going to reverse the ball's y direction so the ball can bounce back. So we will say ball.direction.y multiply minus 1. Now if we save the code and run this code again, and I am moving A or D key to move the paddle, and the paddle can catch the ball. Awesome. So now we have we have a bouncing ball and we have a paddle that can catch this bouncing ball. So in the ball.js, in the check edges function, we don't need to check the bottom of the canvas anymore. So we can just delete this line out. Cool. Because if the ball hits the bottom of the canvas, the game will be over. Great. So now if we run the code again, the ball can bounce around, but if it hits the bottom of the canvas, the ball won't bounce back. Great. The next step is to draw some bricks of different sizes. And when the ball hits one brick, the one brick will either become smaller or be destroyed depending on the size of the brick. So here I have my brick.js file, and in the brick function, I'm going to give each brick its radius. This .r equals to random. P5 has this random function that can generate a random number between 20 and 80. And I'm also going to give each brick its initial XY position. So I will say this dot pos equals to, we will use create vector again. And the X position of each brick will be a random number between 100 to width minus 100. The width of the canvas minus 100, and the Y position of each brick will be a random number between 100 to height divided by minus 400. Okay, so now we gave each brick its radius and its position. And we are also going to have a function called display. In order to draw a polygon, the first thing that I need to do is to translate the origin of the canvas from zero, the left top corner of the canvas, to the XY position of the current polygon. And we're going to draw hexagon. And for hexagon, we have six vertices here. And since the center of the hexagon is 0, 0 now, and we do know the radius of this hexagon, and also we do know this angle is 360 divided by 6, which is 60 degrees. And this is also 2 pi multiplied by 6. And since we know the radius and this angle, we will know for this vertex, its x equals to r multiply cosine angle, and its y position is r multiply its sine angle. So in this way, we will know the x y position for all six vertices, and all we need to do is to connect all six of them, and then we will get a polygon. As we discussed, first we need to translate the origin of the canvas to the XY position of the polygon. So here in the this.display function, I will say translate this.pos.x, this.pos.y. And we are also going to have another property called this.total equals to 6 since it's a hexagon. And you can change this number to 8 or 12 to have other kinds of polygons. And after translate, we are going to have a for loop. Var I equals to 0, I is less than this.total, I plus plus. And in this for loop, I am going to use a function called map from P5 to get the angle. So I will say let angle equals to map, and it will take a variable I, which is from 0 to this dot total. And it will give me an angle which is between 0 to 2 pi. And cool. So we have the angle now. And according to our calculation, we will have the x position of the first vertex, which is var x equals to this star r multiplied by cosine angle, and var y equals to this star r multiplied sine angle. Cool. So now we know the xy position of the first vertex. And we're going to call another function called vertex to create a vertex out of this xy position. And we're going to pass x and y in. And after this for loop, we will have 6 vertices. And now we're going to call begin shape. And end shape after the for loop to create to connect all 6 vertices, and we are also going to pass close to end shape function so the polygon will close itself. The last thing that I need to do is before I translate the origin, I need to use P5's push function to save the current translation, rotation, and drawing settings. And after I finish drawing my first polygon, I will use pop function to restore those settings. Because the translate function will translate the origin based on its previous position, which won't be 0, 0 after we draw the first polygon. So after I draw the first polygon, I will move the origin back to 0, 0. So when I'm drawing the second polygon, the origin will be translated correctly. Now let's go back to sketch.js and to actually create some break object. I will have an empty array called breaks equals to empty array, and in the setup function, I will have a for loop equals to 0, I is less than 20, so we will have 20 breaks, I plus plus, and in this for loop, I am going to create a new break and push this new break object to breaks array. And in the draw function, I'm also going to loop through this breaks array, which will be I var j equals to 0, j is less than breaks dot length, j plus plus. And break j is each break object in this break array, and I will call break j dot display function to actually display the hexagon on the canvas. So now if we run the code, break is not defined. Sketch 30, I think I'm missing an S. And let's run it again. Okay, now if I save the code, cool. So now we will have 20 bricks on the canvas. And the next step is to make the bricks either smaller or destroy this brick when it gets hit by a ball. So in the ball.js, we were also going to have a function called this.hits. And we will pass the brick to this function. And this function will return either true or false. True means the ball is hitting this brick. This is the XY position of the brick. And this is the XY position of the ball. And in P5, there is a function called dist that can calculate the distance between two points. So by using this function, we can get the distance between the brick and the ball. And we will say if the distance is less than the radius of the brick plus the radius of the ball, we will know that the ball is hitting this brick. So here, in the ball.js, in our hits function, we will say, at first we will create a distance function where the distance equals to dist, and we will pass through those two points, this.pass.x, this.pass.y, and the breaks.pass.x, break.pass.y. And we can get the distance between those between the brick and the ball. And then we will say if distance is less than the radius of the brick plus the radius of the ball plus the radius of the brick, we will know that the ball is hitting the brick. So we will return true. Otherwise, we will return false. Cool. So now in the sketch.js, when we're looping through this bricks array, before we display each brick, we will call this function if ball.hits. We pass in this current brick. If ball hits brick is true, we will delete this brick object in this bricks array. In JavaScript, there is a splice function, so we will say bricks.splice. i1. So in this way, the splice function can delete one element in this array at the index of I. Cool. So now we save the code. I is not defined because I should be j. Okay. So if the ball hits the brick will disappear, the brick will disappear, the brick will disappear, the brick will disappear. Next, we're going to add one last feature of this game. So when the ball hits one large brick, the brick will become smaller. So, and if the brick is small enough, the brick will be destroyed. So in the sketch.js, when the ball hits the brick, we were also going to check the size, the radius of the brick. So I would say if this brick, bricks j dot r is more than 40, I will change its radius to itself divided by 2. So if the radius was 60, the new radius will be 30. And if the brick is not big enough, we will just delete it. Cool. And now if we save the code and run the code again, we should be able to see the brick will become either smaller or be destroyed when it got hit by a ball. It does look very weird because the ball doesn't change its direction when it hits a brick. So come back to our code. Here, we are saying if the ball hits a brick, the brick will either become smaller or it will be destroyed. And also the ball should change its direction. So here we will also say ball.direction.y multiply itself by -1. And let's save the code. And if we run the code again, so now when the ball hits a brick, the ball can bounce off. Great, yes. Okay, we're almost there. Bear with me. The last step is to add some logic to this game. In this game, if the ball goes below the canvas, the game should be over. And when all those bricks are destroyed, the player will win this game. So in the sketch.js, we will have two more variables called var playing game, and it will be false at first. And var you win will be false too. And here, when people press S on the keyboard, the game should start. So here I will say in the key press function, I will say if key equals to S or capital S, I will set playing game to true, and I will also reset you win back to false. Here the other thing we're going to do is to check if there is any breaks before we start the game. The reason that we are going to check this is because even though we create 20 blocks at the very beginning, but if the user destroys all those breaks and the game will stop, and then if I press S again, there won't be any breaks. So here I will also say if breaks.length equals to 0, I will create 20 breaks objects and then push it into the breaks array. So I will do breaks.push new break. So in this way, we can make sure if there is no break, we will create 20 more break. And I need to wrap this in a for loop. In this way, we created 20 new break objects if there is no break anymore. So here, if the user press S, we will start the game. And at the beginning, if playing game is false, we're not going to move the paddle or the ball. So here we're going to add another condition saying, if playing game is true, I will update the paddle's position. And if game over, if playing game is true, I will check paddle's edges. Otherwise, I won't. If playing game is true, I will update the ball's position. If game playing is true, I will check edges for this ball. Otherwise, I won't do anything to move the paddle or the ball. So in the draw function, if the ball goes below the canvas, the game will be over. So playing game will be false. Also, we're going to move the ball back to the center of the canvas. So we will say if ball.position.y is more than height, playing game will be false, and we will say ball.position equals to create vector with divide by 2, height divide by 2. So in this way, we move the ball back to the center of the canvas. Also, if there is no breaks on the canvas anymore, that means you win this game. So I will also check if breaks.length is 0. If this happens, you win. It's true. I will also stop the game. So playing game is false. Cool. So now let's show some text on the canvas when player wins the game. P5 has another library called p5.dom that can do a lot of DOM manipulations, kind of like jQuery. We already included this p5.dom library in our index.html. So now we can just use p5.dom to create a p.html element. So at first, we're going to have a variable called win tags that holds our text. I will have a function called create text. Here I will say win text equals to create p, you win. This create p function is from p5.dom. It will create a HTML p element. We will give this HTML element a position. The position equals to width divided by 2, height minus 50 and 80. At first, your wing is false, and we're going to hide this text. We're gonna do it later. In the display, in the draw function, we will say if your wing is true, we were going to show the text. And if your wing is false, we're going to hide this text. So with p5.dom library, we can just say win text.style display. If your wing is true, we're going to show it. So it should be block And if your win is false, we're going to hide this text. So win text.style, display, none. Great. So I think this is the end of all the code. And let's save the code and to see if it works. Okay, cannot read property y of undefined 44. Not position, it's pause. And this is pause too, okay. So now, cannot read property style of undefined 57. Oh, because we didn't call this create text function. So here in the setup function, we're also going to call create text to create this text first, and then in the draw function, we will hide or show this text depending on the variable you win. Now if we refresh the page, we will see this game and the ball will stop at the center of the canvas. And when I press S, the ball will start moving. And the brick will become smaller, will be destroyed by the ball. And it will take a while for me to win this game. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Yes. Okay, so now if you win this game, the you win text will show up on the canvas too. Okay, awesome. This is just a basic version of the game. There are a lot more things that you can do to improvise. You can create different kinds of breaks. You can add colors and animations to the ball and to the breaks. You can also add sound effects on interactions. You could also design difficulty levels and rewards. For example, you can make stars fall down when a break got hit by a ball. And if the paddle catches the star, the score will increase. On the GitHub README, there is a place for you to link your version of the code. Feel free to submit a pull request to share your game with me. Thank you so much for watching. Bye bye.